Thank you for leading us into God's presence, worship team. Please join me in praying. Father, here we are. It is good to be in your presence. It's good to be in your house and surrounded by your family. And now as we prepare to hear your message for us today, we lay down our worries and our cares and our burdens, the normal ones and the exceptional ones. And we want to focus our minds purely on you. Help us to do that. And later when we leave, help us to leave those burdens with you and to walk out carrying your rest for our souls and carrying a joy and a freedom and a peace that we can share with other people this coming week. And now as my brother Greg prepares to speak to us, fill him with your spirit and give him your words that you will be speaking through his mouth to our hearts, the message that each one of us needs to hear. Let your word take root in us and bear great fruit. In Jesus' name, amen.
We are glad you are here with us today. Pastor Dustin and Kara are in Indianapolis at the Nazarene General Assembly, which has people from all over the world that will be there this week. So when you think of it, would you be praying? Because they will be making decisions, just different things. It's just a matter of prayer. Then we have the opportunity to lift up to God. Lots of good things happening. Tuesday, we get a new youth pastor. Joel and Tori will be joining us. So they are newlyweds. If you would like to bless them, we have a basket in the back. I shop at Aldi's, and I'm figuring they're going to be filling their pantry for the first time. So any way you would like to bless them, just drop that card off. Wednesday night, they're going to be meeting with our teenagers here so the teens can get to know them. Then we come up next Sunday morning, which is going to be Father's Day. It's also Baptism Sunday. I got to thinking, what better way, if we have a dad out there that hasn't ever taken that next step of baptism, what a great opportunity to set the example for your family in going through that public confession of your faith through baptism. Also, if you're a dad between services, you get to have donuts back in the kids' area with your kids. So too bad for the rest of you that don't fit that category, but we have other ways to bless you. Also, it's the time to return the baby bottles. If you've been taking one of the empty bottles back there, putting your change in it, then that's going to bless life choices that helps other moms and dads as they go into that journey of parenthood. Okay, if you've been procrastinating, time's up. This is the week to sign up. If you've got kids, camp age, which is basically first to third, fourth to sixth, and then teens. Teens will go to Camp Table Rock. The others will be going to Camp Siokomo. How many of you remember back to the impact that camp had on you as a kid? And it can be a life-changing time. So if you've got kids in that category, make sure you get them signed up with Miss Heather this week. Okay, so we are blessed this morning to have Greg Coolidge speak to us. We heard from Jennifer on Mother's Day. And then today we get to hear from Greg. He came to us from Colorado where they manage a homeless shelter. So I reached out to Jennifer. I said, okay, tell me about Greg. Because, you know, he lives with him 24/7. I may be able to say, oh, he preaches a good sermon. But she lives with him day in, day out. Okay, here is what she had to say. He's a man on fire for God's word. He loves Jesus and he loves people. He longs to see the church have a deep and mature understanding of all God has freely given us who have received Christ. Wow. You know, that's way more impressive than whether he brings flowers on special occasions to have a godly man like that leading the home, working through the crisis center, and this morning being God's spokesman for us. So thank you, Greg.
There we go. Whoa. Okay. But my wife is awesome, as you found out on Mother's Day, huh? She's pretty cool. Also, just along with that, just a word of praise for you all. Praise report. She shared with you about some of her daughters, and one of them in particular, Brandy. We've been praying for them all, of course, and Brandy's been the trouble child, the one that's just, you know, the hellion of the family, you know, kind of thing. And anyway, as it has come about, as soon as she was done on Mother's Day, she got to leave here and go to Casey and be with her daughter that Sunday, and she has been with her subsequent times since then. And Brandy has definitely made a commitment to the Lord and received Him and was baptized a couple Sundays back ago. And on top of that, you know, just really seeing some real fruit in her life where she's actually making grown-up decisions, and she's seeing that God is interceding in prayer. When she asks, God answers, and she's acknowledging that. And those are amazing things for me to share that with you, especially when you've, yeah. Since we work with a lot of those people who have made a lot of wrong life choices, you know, survival is really hard for them to break away from, you know, because they know the skills that they need to live on the street and to get things done, and a lot of it's manipulation and so forth. And for somebody to surrender those and walk through the steps of, you mean I have to apply for a job? Well, will they hire me? Well, let's pray about it. God will open doors. Oops, God opened doors. I got a job. Now, you know, and all these things. And she sees making right choices, and God just opens the doors as she's given his, you know, her life to him. So I just wanted to share that with you because I know many of you prayed. I know the men's group that we get together once a month, and in a small group, you know, the guys that I've circled with, we've shared burdens for each other's children and prayer requests. And so I want to thank the guys that have rallied around me too as far as that goes. But man, it's awesome to see your family coming to the Lord. That's awesome. So anyway, and like I told the first service, I really appreciate Dustin, but you need to appreciate him more because you have an amazingly risky pastor who's very bold and very confident, okay? First of all, he's an amazing risk taker because he just trusts me to be here this morning and take his pulpit and share with his sheep. So that's a huge risk taker. He's bold because he's got to face you when he gets back. And then he's super confident because he knows he can fix anything I mess up. So you serve an awesome pastor. So with that being said, we're going to stand for the reading of God's word. I'm doing something really different today that I've never done before. I'm usually very much have all my notes together, and I have all my little slide presentations, and I love to have my little transitions with my little tricky word phrases and give you little catchphrases and things to learn and to, you know, to, and this time, you know, it's funny because Dustin and I were talking. He goes, man, I just want the guys to just share from the overflow of what God's doing in their lives. And I thought, well, he certainly does pour in. I mean, he pours in and pours in and pours in, but, you know, I like this control thing and this whole, and I know God works through that and all that, but I thought, you know what? It's not my church. I can experiment. Why not? I'm just going to wing it. I'm just going to see what God really, okay, God, I'm going to trust you. Let's just see what you do. And I'm just going to pour out what he's poured into me. You know, when he fills us with the Holy Spirit, the Bible never describes it as a lake. It's not supposed to just sit in there. He calls it a river. Flows, torrents of water will flow out of you. So whatever God has given, it's got to come out. So let's pray that it comes out. So I want you to stand for the reading of God's word. And here's how we're going to do it. Since there's all different translations of Bibles, I am in John chapter 14, verse 8. But your translation might be different than mine. So if we were to all read it at the same time in different translations, it might sound like the upper room on the day of Pentecost, okay? But I'm going to quote it from mine, and I'm going to have you repeat it, okay? And I'm going to start with this side, and we'll work our way through. This scripture comes from, here's the setting, Jesus is coming to the end of his ministry. He's just hours before his arrest and going to his trial in the cross. He's spending some time with his disciples, and he just shared with him that his time was up and he was leaving. They didn't know where he was going, and so he kind of shared with them where he was going. And then as soon as he was done sharing that, Philip speaks up and says, Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. So that's it. Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. I'm going to go back here because they were weak. Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. All right. Now you should be experts, right? Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, as I look around this room, I see all diversities of life in ages, sizes, shapes, colors, everyone with different personalities, characteristics, and talents, and all of them that you've created, Lord, all special, all different, but all one. But Father, only you can do what you do uniquely, and that's to speak to each and everyone's individual heart individually. So Lord, there's no way I could mastermind any kind of a sermon that's going to speak to everyone. Only you can do that. So Father, I'm going to rest and depend on you. I'm going to ask that you would take this vessel and speak through it. Let these words be you, and may they speak to each individual person as they need to hear what they need today. And then, Father, with the Holy Spirit, may it just convict enough to stir up, Lord, that heart and that ground to prepare it for the planting and the seed of that word. And, Father, from this day forward, may that seed begin to take root. May it begin to grow. And, Father, may it bud and give forth fruit. And so, Father, we just ask these things in your precious name. Amen. You may be seated. Now, the verse that I had you read is, or repeat after me, I should say. That's the end of the story. We're going to jump to the movie. Am I shorting out or something there? Anyway, you love those movies that they start out and they show you the end, and then it fades away, and then it goes way back to the beginning, and there's a bunch of little kids and so forth, and you know, and so then they work through the rest of the story, but you kind of already know how it's going to end. But I'm going to take you to the beginning of the story. We have a kingdom set up for us that people have been living in the last 4,000 years or so, and within this kingdom, God has revealed himself through his people, the Israelites. He's given them his law, and with that law, he has certainly proven that we are disobedient kids, okay? Yet the law is designed to show us just how disobedient we are. I kind of look at the law as a mirror. Most of you ladies can relate to this. You walk by a mirror, and the whole reason you look in it is to see if there's anything that's out of place. Does anything need to be adjusted? Is my hair okay? Do I need to add a little makeup? Do I need to do this or that or whatever? Okay, so the mirror reflects that which is wrong with you. Okay, that which needs to be adjusted, that which needs to be corrected. Now, how many of you ladies have ever then just walked up and just started rubbing all over the mirror and then walked away and it corrected the issue? Okay, so the mirror does not correct the issue. It really shows you the truth of the issue, but it doesn't correct the issue. In this kingdom of fallen people, God's mirror of righteousness stands before them. And they have actually come to believe that they can rub against the mirror and somehow make them righteous. Now, this is the kingdom with which they've become accustomed to live in. However, they are alerted through the prophets that there's one day a kingdom that's going to come and be established on earth. And God is going to establish that kingdom. And you know what? They are ready for that kingdom because the kingdoms they think about is the mighty kingdom of their King David and King Solomon, who during those times they were mighty warriors. And they took everything by force and took what God promised them and occupied that land and so forth. And so the mindset of that kingdom was that we're going to take over this world, especially this mean, oppressive Roman government, and we're going to show them, wait till my God gets here, and he's going to dust you all, okay? That was sort of the mindset. However, I could do some analogies to show you that we kind of live in this same mindset today politically, but I'm not going to. I'll just let you make that up for yourselves. I guess what I'm trying to say is the answer isn't necessarily that throne, it's that throne, okay? But anyway, we'll leave that for another day. But this kingdom now needs an adjustment because the God who put us on this earth knows we need fixed and the mirror's not fixing it. The Bible tells us that he sends his son and he's going to fix this issue. And in Philippians chapter 2, it tells us that Jesus is God. John chapter 1 tells us Jesus is God. We know in many scriptures that Jesus is God. Yet, he decides to empty himself out completely of his deity and his power and become a man. And he entered the womb of a woman to be born just like a man. Now, I don't know how many of you have memories of what it was like the 9 months you were inside your mother's womb. But I'm sure it wasn't comfortable. I'm sure it was very humid, very moist and sloppy. But all I'm saying is, can you imagine the creator of the universe reducing himself to becoming a man and in the womb? And then he's birthed like any ordinary person. He had to have his diapers changed. His mom had to clean up the Cheerio bowl that he threw on the floor. All of the things that little kids did and all children and all, you know, whatever. He went through those things. He was a man. And there's a reason for that. Because when John starts his ministry, he begins to blow his horn saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Now, if you ever met John the Baptist, you'd probably repent or run. The Bible tells us that he was the original hippie. He lived in the wilderness, didn't take a bath, wore ugly clothes, and ate bugs. Could you imagine being his mom? "John, put that cricket down." But John had one message and he had one thing to do, and that was prepare the way for this new kingdom and the person who would introduce it. So he went around, "Repent, be baptized, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Jesus meets up with his cousin John, and there he's at the River Jordan. He's baptizing. John sees him, says, "Behold, the Lamb of the world who takes away, behold, the perfect Lamb that takes away the sins of the world." And doesn't want to baptize him at first, and Jesus says, "You got to fill these scriptures." And there's a reason why. So he's baptized, and the heavens open up. The Holy Spirit falls on him. "Here's the voice of God. This is my son in whom I'm well pleased." He's led by the Holy Spirit into the desert to be tempted for 40 days and 40 nights in an incredible way. But here's what I'm trying to tell you is Jesus did everything necessary to bring himself from this kingdom into this kingdom. And he did it not because he was God. He did it as a man to show you, you can do it as a man too. But I'm going to do it with the power of the Holy Spirit and my Father. Do you know Jesus was such a man, an ordinary man, that on his own, he could never heal anybody. He couldn't raise any dead. He couldn't walk on water. He couldn't do any of the things that he did. He was just like us. And he says so. He tells his disciples clearly, "I only do what the Father tells me to do. I only say what the Father tells me to say. It is by his power in me that I do what I do." Why did he do that? To take us from this kingdom to this kingdom. So this morning we're going to talk about that kingdom, because Jesus now starts out his ministry and his message is, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Or basically he's saying, "Repent, the kingdom is here." Ta-da, it's here. All right. So we get stuck on that word repentance, and I really believe that somehow as Christians, we've kind of gotten the word a little bit askewed. And so, therefore, I think we have enough repentance to get forgiveness of sins, and we haven't repented enough to get into the new kingdom. This word repentance, sometimes we align it with confession. And it kind of is. But confession is not repentance. See, I can confess to you all the things that I've done wrong. And I can turn around and do them again. And I can confess them and turn around and do them again. And confess them and turn around and do them again. So is confession repentance? No. The Bible tells us that a sorrowful confession leads us to repentance, or being sorry for our sins. It's something leads us to repentance. In other words, you have to get to a place where you're saying, I don't want to be that anymore. I don't want to live like that anymore. I want to be different. And you turn and take on another direction. You see, you go the opposite way. You leave that behind. Now, that's repentance. So he's saying, repent of the way or the concept or the construct or the kingdom you used to live in. That's this one I painted for you. And repent, turn from that one and go into this one. Now, this is not very easy, and it's going to take about 3 years for him to teach his disciples. And then a little more of a splash of the baptism on the day of Pentecost for it to penetrate what actually is taking place. But we're going to try and wrap this up in about 30 minutes, okay? Here they are, schooled in this kingdom, just like you and I. We don't know any different. Our thoughts, how we analyze things, our methodologies, all of those things are of this school of thought. Now, the interesting thing is we weren't created that way in the beginning. We were created in the image of God. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 tells us that in the beginning, God created, but then he created as he went down the days of creation. He says, let us create man in our image. And he said, and in our image, we created them, male and female. Therefore, we are the image of our Creator. But he also said, the day you eat of the fruit thereof, you shall surely die. Well, we understand that when Adam and Eve did disobey God and eat of the fruit in the garden, they didn't drop dead, but something died. That image of what they were created to be died. And guess what image they received? Their father, Satan, now. And that was passed on, including us. Don't be offended that we're all spawns of Satan, okay? It just is what it is. If you don't believe me, put 2 2-year-olds in a room alone with one toy and see what happens. Did you teach them to act like that? Or did it come naturally? Is that God's nature? Or is that Satan's nature? So, this is the kingdom we've been schooled in. This is how we think. This is how we analyze. This is how we try to fix things. We do it all in this thing right here, this fallen, wrecked, messed up kingdom. Jesus comes on the scene and he says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So not only does he want us to turn from our sins, but we have to put on a whole new way of thinking. New attitude. Wasn't there a song? I need a new attitude. Jesus said, let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus. Paul tells us in Romans 8 that the mind of the world is enmity. It's at war with God. They don't go together, but the mind of the Spirit. Now, that has fellowship with God. And then it continues in chapter 12 to tell us that this is something we need to do as believers. that we present ourselves as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing unto Him. And that's our reasonable act of worship or service. And then and then the next verse says that we be transformed, be ye transformed. Do not conform to the things of this world or the ways of this world or the thinking of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Start thinking. You're going to start thinking over here. So what does that thinking look like? Okay. Kingdom. I'm a king. Or I'm not a king, but a kingdom needs a king. And Jesus is going to introduce the kingdom. And a kingdom needs subjects. So he picks 12 of these guys. And it would be fun to go through all that, but we don't have time for all that. But now he has his 12. And now he's going to begin to teach them. So let's look at it this way. 12 guys, basic training, going to get taught how to live in this kingdom. All right? Jesus is going to take them through it step by step. So they sit down on the Sermon of the Mount. Now, the Bible says that other people came and joined him, but it clearly says, and he spoke to his disciples. So he was focusing on his recruits, his new recruits. So I can imagine what they're thinking. Yeah, I'm one mean green fight machine, Jesus. You got the best guys. We're going to go in there. We're going to romp and stomp and we're going to kick some tail and take names and all that kind of stuff. And we're going to change this world. We're going to show them what this God kingdom's all about. And da-da-da. And I'm sure they probably were talking about, well, I want to be a fighter jet pilot and I want to shoot nukes and I want to be a tanker and I want to be a this and that. And we're going to show them how this is done. And we're going to take by force and we're going to be mighty. And we're going to teach these people how to be holy and godly and righteous. And Jesus says, now, wait a minute. We're going to do something different. See, it's not like this kingdom. This kingdom looks like its king. And when you begin to read through the Sermon of the Mount, all of a sudden, the script starts getting flipped, doesn't it? He'll start saying things like, do you want to learn to live? Then you must die. Do you want to be great in this kingdom? Well, then you have to be the servant of all. You know that it's said, thou shalt not commit adultery, but I say, if you even look at another woman with lust in your heart, you've already committed. That's what this kingdom's all about. This kingdom says this. This king, and boy, I'll tell you what, his recruits are kind of going, I'm not sure that I wanted to sign up for this one. And then all of a sudden he says, you know how we're going to take the world? This is how we're going to do it. We're going to kill him with kindness. We're going to show him what our Heavenly Father is all about. Because you are going to represent him. He created you in his image to look like him. We're going to restore it, and you're going to start looking just like him. You know how I know that? Because Jesus looked just like the Father. Everywhere you look in Scripture, you see Jesus doing these wonderful things. He is perfect theology. Did you know that? If you want to know anything about God, study Jesus. Hebrews 1 tells us he's the perfect facsimile of the Father. Jesus said, when you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Because he only does what the Father tells him to do. He only says what the Father tells him to say. And therefore, he is a complete reflection of his Heavenly Father. In fact, to answer Philip's question, he said, when you've seen me, Philip, how long do I have to be with you, Philip? Don't you know that when you've seen me, you've seen the Father? Kind of interesting. So what is he trying to do? He's trying to restore us back so we come back over to this kingdom and we start living in this kingdom. But we're going to look just like our king. And we're going to do things just like our king does them. And our king loves people. Do you know how I know that? Because the Bible tells me so. And Jesus lived it out. You see, 1 John 4:7-8 says, beloved, let us love one another. For love is of God. Anyone who loves knows God. Anyone who doesn't love does not know God, because God is love. If we were to take some of the things that we know about love, definition-wise, not the eros love or phileo love, but agape love that we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. If the things that are listed in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 are truly love and God is love, then they should look like each other, right? All right, let's name a few of them. Love is patient. That's God. That's Jesus. That's the Holy Spirit. He's long-suffering. That's God. That's Jesus. That's the Holy Spirit. Keeps no record of wrong. That's God. That's Jesus. That's the Holy Spirit. He doesn't delight in evil, but he rejoices in the good. That's God. That's Jesus. That's all. Guess what? He looks just like love. So now let me share with you a little scripture here from Matthew. We're down into the Sermon on the Mount. And Jesus is sharing with them some things, and he gets to this part in chapter 5, verse 43. And he says, I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Can you imagine being in basic training and you're recruiting for a new kingdom and this is the information you're getting? I came in post-Vietnam, but it's still right at the tail end of it. They just had, I couldn't imagine sitting down and on the day we get drilled or get our orientation that our general stands up and says, guess what, guys, we're going to do? We're going to love our enemies. We're going to pray for those who persecute us. Sound a little awkward, wouldn't it? It's different thinking, isn't it? But that's the thinking we've all been brought up with. I come home with a black eye from school. My dad says, what's the other guy look like? First words out of his mouth. And if he doesn't, you better go back and finish it. What's that teaching us? You see what I'm saying? Kingdom thinking, different. You have heard that it is said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. Is he saying that if we love people, we're going to look like Dad? I think so. I think he's introducing something brand new, because first of all, this is what got Jesus put on the cross, because he claimed to be the Son of God. You see, they didn't think we could have that kind of connection with the Father. But the Father says, oh no, I designed you that way. I put my image in you. He causes his Son to rise on the evil and the good. He sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that? All right, here's the good scripture right here. Be ye perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. You guys still want to be a recruit? You still in? Is he talking about not losing your car keys? Forgetting to put gas in the car before your wife leaves on a trip? Is he talking about losing your daughter's cheerleading outfit tonight before the game or not washing it? Is he talking about those kinds of things? Mm-mm. He's talking about a heart and an attitude lived out in love. Paul in Galatians 5 says the only thing that counts is living out your faith in love. So if God is the perfect love, no, we won't have the power of God. That's not what he wants us to have. He's God. He created us for certain things in His image, and that image is to reflect certain things, and that certain thing we're supposed to reflect is the very character and heart of who our King is, and that is His love, and that's what we're supposed to do. And this is what He's beginning to teach His recruits, and He begins to take them through this process. Can we actually become a reflection of God? You know, there's sometimes when I teach these things to my guys, and I get to teach them every morning, which is fun, but I always get this. Somebody will say, "We can't do that. We're not Jesus." And I'll say, "Yes, you can. Because Jesus said you can. Jesus said you will do the same things I do, even greater. If you say that you have fellowship with me, you will walk as I walk. If you will do what I do," well, actually, he doesn't say if, he says do what I do. Because he said, "I'm the teacher, you are the student. The student is not greater than the teacher. You follow what I do, you do what I do." Would he tell us to do what he did if we couldn't do it? It's because we haven't stepped over into this kingdom. We're trying to serve Jesus in this kingdom. And it doesn't work that way, does it? The Pharisees found out. They tried to challenge Jesus in every way. And they were smart in the scriptures. He even let them know that they were smart in the scriptures. And he said, "You search the scriptures every day looking for eternal life. And those scriptures speak of me. And you won't accept me. But oh, you know the Bible. But you haven't stepped over into the kingdom." So what we do is we live this life with a lot of excuses and alibis why we can't look like our Father. And there's a world crying out there, "Just show us the Father and it'll be enough." God definitely wants us to be participants in everything that He has done for us and shown us. And He sends His disciples out to go out. He says, I'm sending you out. Let me see where that scripture is. I know I wrote it down here somewhere. See what happens when you don't do notes that are systematic? There's a couple of things He does. Not only does He send them out, but He also tells them in His sermon that we are the salt of the earth. He lets them know that, hey, you guys are going to be the salt of the earth. All right? If salt loses its saltiness, there's no flavor, it's not any good. Then He says, you're the light of the world. If the light, you know, we put it up on a hill. A city is on a hill so all can see it. But if that light is hidden, then what good is it? And again, what is He telling us? He's telling His disciples, I'm sending you out. When He sends them out, He even says this. He goes, I'm sending you out as sheep to wolves. Boy, that's encouraging for your recruits, right? But what? I'll be with you. Amen. All right. So this kingdom is supposed to invade this kingdom. But we're going to invade them with love. Okay? And only do that when we've surrendered this kingdom and repented and came into this kingdom. And say, Father, I want to look just like you created me to be. Jesus, you've made that possible because you've reconciled the sin issue. All sin is forgiven. We've been reconciled unto the Father. And now we have been restored to the position we've been given in the beginning, and that is our identity in Christ and who we are in God, created to be His children. We have been adopted as sons and daughters. We can now come into the throne boldly and call Him Dad again. I mean, isn't that amazing? We have so many wonderful things, and what are we going to do with those things? It's really hard to live in this, or be this, and live in this. And a lot of times we even kind of do this blending thing where we kind of try to blend worldly ideologies and methodologies and so forth, God's methods, and it's his methods are his ways are not our ways, the Bible says. In fact, if you had a tape measure that could go from the surface of the earth to wherever the outer edge of space is, I'm not sure where that's at, but if you had a tape measure that far, the Bible says that's how different my ways are than your ways. My thoughts are from your thoughts. But I want you to step in and embrace that kingdom. I want you to think like that. I want you to look like that. The Pharisees thought they had this thing nailed. They were going to show Jesus what he was made out of. They caught a woman in adultery. Caught her in adultery, the Bible says. My guess is that she probably didn't have time to get clothes, and even if she was going to, they probably didn't want her to because they wanted as much shame and public humiliation as they could possibly get because she was a sinner. It was early in the morning, the Bible tells us, and Jesus was in the courts of the temple there, teaching, and they brought her before him. And they were trying to trick him and ask him this question to see if he would have the right answer, because he'd really been displaying a whole lot of this mercy and compassion stuff. But this is black and white law. What is he going to do with this? And they bring her before him and they say, Jesus, what are you going to do with this? She was caught in adultery. The laws of Moses say she should be stoned to death. They were correct. We don't know what he wrote in the sand. I've heard some wonderful sermons. Pretty good guesses probably that whatever he wrote in the sand, they were able to read, and whatever they read convicted their lives because they knew they were guilty too. And it said one by one, they left from the oldest to the youngest. They dropped their stones and walked away. Here's what's so awesome is the position of Jesus. When you read it in the scriptures, you will find that it says that he looked up to her. He wasn't standing above her, scolding her. And he said, where are your accusers? He said, I don't accuse you either. That's not my Father's kingdom. Paul in Colossians says that we now have this ministry of reconciliation as if we were his ambassadors. Representations. We are. How many people do you know that are caught up in all kinds of things, humiliated with their lifestyle? Do we throw stones? Do we shun them? Do we push them away? Or do we look at what is book and let them know you're not who you think you are? You're living in a different kingdom under a different king. But I want to tell you, you got a creator who knows exactly who you are, and he created you to be like him. And you're not living up to the potential that he created you to be. You're wearing clothes that don't fit you. And I'm telling you right now, I don't hold this against you either. But I want you to know you can live different, and you can be different. Isn't it wonderful that we have this ministry of reconciliation, Paul says? Every one of you. That's how we're going to take this kingdom. We're going to take this kingdom by loving people into it. I'm running short on time, and I'm just going to leave this in your mind, but in Matthew chapter 24, somewhere around verse, I believe it's around 17 or so, when Jesus is sharing about the end times and what's going to take place in the last days, he says, because of the increase of wickedness, the agape love of many will wax cold. I blew over that scripture a million times until just up a couple years ago, and then it hit me in the forehead. He's talking about me. That because of the amount of godliness and sinfulness and the things that are going on in our world that we all get together and talk about and how angry we are about, it begins to fester in us, and it begins to wax. Our love will wax cold in these last days. And I'm telling you, you've been created for a time and place. God had it specifically in mind. And you're needed right here and right now in this generation, in this place, in this town, right where you occupy at your job, your school, wherever you're at. You are to be a part of the kingdom that's going to invade this one. But you can't invade this one if you don't have this one. And so this morning, all I'm going to do is challenge you to the next step. If you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you're working through these things, but you just haven't put this whole, what is this kingdom he's talking about? It's not something that we just accepted the Lord, and now we got our ticket punched, and we're going to heaven. No, Jesus came to put heaven into us. So that while we're here on earth, we could be the reflection of our Father to everyone around us. And we're not just Christians and just hanging on and just praying for one another to get by until he comes and takes us off this earth. This isn't about getting by. This is about doing his business. And he needs you. He needs all of us. And he's calling you to be that person, to step up and say, you know what? I'll do it. Father, I'm weak. I don't have nothing. He goes, good. No, I can feel you. I don't want you to have anything. I want to be able to one working through you. I want you to see that you've got a king that lives in you and wants to work through you. And we're going to change the world one person at a time. In your circle of concern, if you're working in some secular job and you're dissatisfied because of all the nonsense that you see going on and the bickering, the gossiping, the pornography, the jokes, whatever it is, man, you're right where God wants you to be. Don't pray for a new job. Pray for everybody you're working with. You're penetrating a different kingdom. Do it. Do it for him, because that's what he created you to be, is to be his light. So let's stand and we'll sing the song in closing. If anybody wants to pray, they're more than welcome to come and pray. As always, this altar is always open in this church. My wife and I will be here if you want to pray with us. We'll pray with you. We'll be more than happy to. But I just really want you to take this call seriously. Don't let your love wax cold. I know there's a lot of evil darkness going on in this world, but we're still here to make a difference. And as long as you got breath, let's live for him and make a difference. Okay?
is through. But since when has impossible ever stopped you? Friday's disappointment is Sunday's empty tomb. Since when has impossible ever stopped you? This is the sound of dry bones rattling. This is the praise make a dead man walk again. Open the grave, I'm coming out. I'm gonna live again. This is the sound of dry bones rattling. Pentecostal fire stirring something new. You're not gonna run out of miracles anytime soon. He's